Hence, fantastic vapors, what are ye to this? Where are the dreams of the hero when he learns he has a child? Nature is taking him to her bosom. She will speak presently. Every domesticated boar in these hills can boast the same. Yet marvels the hero at none of his visioned prodigies as he does when he comes to hear of this most common performance. A father. Richard fixed his eyes as if he were trying to make out the lineaments of his child, telling Austin he would be back in a few minutes. He sallied into the air and walked on and on. A father, he kept repeating to himself. A child. And though he knew it not, he was striking the keynotes of nature. But he did know of a singular harmony that suddenly burst over his whole being. The moon was surpassingly bright, the summer air heavy and still. He left the high road and pierced into the forest. His walk was rapid. The leaves on the trees brushed his cheeks. The dead leaves heaped in the dells noised to his feet. Something of a religious joy, a strange sacred pleasure, was in him. By degrees it wore. He remembered himself, and now he was possessed by a proportionate anguish. A father. He dared never see his child, and he had no longer his fantasies to fall upon. He was utterly bare to his sin. In his troubled mind, it seemed to him that Claire looked down on him, Claire who saw him as he was, and that to her eyes, it would be infamy for him to go and print his kiss upon his child. Then came stern efforts to command his misery and make the nerves of his face iron. By the log of an ancient tree, half buried in dead leaves of past summers, beside a brook, he halted as one who had reached his journey's end. There he discovered he had a companion in Lady Judith's little dog. He gave the friendly animal a pat of recognition, and both were silent in the forest silence. It was impossible for Richard to return. His heart was surcharged. He must advance, and on he footed, the little dog following. An oppressive slumber hung about the forest branches. In the dells and on the heights was the same dead heat. Here, where the brook tinkled, it was no cool-lipped sound, but metallic, and without the spirit of water. Yonder, in a space of moonlight on lush grass, the beams were as white fire to sight and feeling. No haze spread round. The valleys were clear, defined to the shadows of their verges, the distances sharply distinct, and with the colours of day but slightly softened. Richard beheld a roe moving across a slope of sward far out of rifle mark. The breathless silence was significant, yet the moon shone in a broad blue heaven. Tongue out of mouth trotted the little dog after him, couched panting when he stopped an instant, rose wearily when he started afresh. Now and then a large white night moth flitted through the dusk of the forest. On a barren corner of the wooded highland, looking inland, stood grey topless ruins, set in nettles and rank grass blades. Richard mechanically sat down on the crumbling flints to rest and listened to the panting of the dog. Sprinkled at his feet were emerald lights. Hundreds of glowworms studded the dark, dry ground. He sat and eyed them, thinking not at all. His energies were expended in action. He sat as a part of the ruins, and the moon turned his shadow westward from the south. Overhead, as she declined, long ripples of silver cloud were imperceptibly stealing toward her. They were the van of a tempest. He did not observe them, or the leaves beginning to chatter. When he again pursued his course with his face to the Rhine, a huge mountain appeared to rise sheer over him, and he had it in his mind to scale it. He got no nearer to the base of it for all his vigorous outstepping. The ground began to dip. He lost sight of the sky. Then heavy thunderdrops struck his cheek. The leaves were singing. The earth breathed. It was black before him and behind. All at once the thunder spoke. The mountain he had marked was bursting over him. Up started the whole forest in violet fire. He saw the country at the foot of the hills to the bounding Rhine, gleam, quiver, extinguished. Then there were pauses, and the lightning seemed as the eye of heaven, and the thunder as the tongue of heaven, each alternately addressing him. filling him with awful rapture. Alone there, sole human creature among the grandeurs and mysteries of storm, he felt the representative of his kind, and his spirit rose and marched and exulted. Let it be glory, let it be ruin. Lower down the lightened abysses of Erl rolled the wrathful crash. Then white thrusts of light were darted from the sky, and great curving ferns, seen steadfast in pallor a second, were supernaturally agitated and vanished. Then a shrill song roused in the leaves and the herbage. Prolonged and louder it sounded, as deeper and heavier the deluge pressed. A mighty force of water satisfied the desire of the earth. Even in this, drenched as he was by the first outpouring, Richard had a savage pleasure. Keeping in motion, he was scarcely conscious of the wet, and the grateful breath of the weeds was refreshing. Suddenly, he stopped short, lifting a curious nostril. He fancied he smelt meadow sweet. He had never seen the flower in Rhineland, never thought of it, and it would hardly be met with in a forest. He was sure he smelt it fresh in dews. His little companion wagged a miserable wet tail some way in advance. He went on slowly, thinking indistinctly. After two or three steps, he stooped and stretched out his hand to feel for the flower, having, he knew not why, a strong wish to verify its growth there. Groping about, his hand encountered something warm that started at his touch, and he, with the instinct we have, seized it and lifted it to look at it. The creature was very small, evidently quite young. Richard's eyes, now accustomed to the darkness, were able to discern it for what it was, a tiny leveret, and he supposed that the dog had probably frightened its dam just before he found it. He put the little thing on one hand in his breast and stepped out rapidly as before. The rain was now steady. From every tree a fountain poured. So cool and easy had his mind become that he was speculating on what kind of shelter the birds could find, and how the butterflies and moths saved their colored wings from washing. Folded close, they might hang under a leaf, he thought. Lovingly, he looked into the dripping darkness of the coverts on each side as one of their children. Then he was musing on a strange sensation he experienced. It ran up one arm with an indescribable thrill, but communicated nothing to his heart. It was purely physical, ceased for a time and recommenced, till he had it all through his blood, wonderfully thrilling. He grew aware that the little thing he carried in his breast was licking his hand there, the small, rough tongue going over and over the palm of his hand produced this strange sensation he felt. Now that he knew the cause, the marvel ended, but now that he knew the cause, his heart was touched and made more of it. The gentle scraping continued without intermission as on he walked. What did it say to him? Human tongue could not have said so much just then. A pale grey light on the skirts of the flying tempest displayed the dawn. Richard was walking hurriedly. The green drenched weeds lay all about in his path, bent thick, and the forest drooped glimmeringly. Impelled as a man who feels a revelation mounting obscurely to his brain, Richard was passing one of those little forest chapels, hung with votive wreaths, where the peasant halts to kneel and pray. Cold, still, in the twilight it stood, raindrops pattering round it. He looked within and saw the Virgin holding her child. He moved by, but not many steps had he gone ere his strength went out of him and he shuddered. What was it? He asked not. He was in other hands. Vivid as lightning, the spirit of life illumined him. He felt in his heart the cry of his child, his darling's touch. With shut eyes he saw them both. They drew him from the depths. They led him a blind and tottering man. And as they led him, he had a sense of purification so sweet he shuddered again and again. When he looked out from his trance on the breathing world, the small birds hopped and chirped. Warm, fresh sunlight was over all the hills. He was on the edge of the forest, entering a plain cloak with ripe corn under a spacious morning sky.